visit cities of the world whose history and culture are both unique and different. A journey to places whose names sound familiar and yet much is unknown. An extraordinary journey to the capitals of culture. During the Middle Ages, Venice was the most powerful trading metropolis in Europe's Adriatic and Eastern Mediterranean. Nowadays, the sea penetrates the city and overflows onto the Piazza San Marco several times a year. But still, the Basilica, with its Oriental and Byzantine influences, is an impressive sight. The courageous, winged golden lion became a symbol of the Venetian Sea Republic's newfound power. The dark years of the Holy Inquisition also left their mark here, as did the excessive festivities surrounding the Carnival of Venice. The city's main canals are Venice's equivalent to our roadways, and the gondoliers have still not lost any of their old-world charm. The great art of opera is also represented. And the residents and visitors are always ready to indulge themselves in its magic. The Black Death annihilated large parts of the population while the sea, the beloved and sometimes feared Bride of Venice, also took its annual toll. Famous personalities such as Casanova and Cagliostro lived here, their decadent lives having made their own unique contribution to the city's historic reputation. The most prosperous of the city's families erected their palazzi on the city's canal banks. The foundations of these buildings are supported by thousands of pillars. No expense was spared as they promoted the arts. Thus, painters like Giorgione or Titian became famous and recognized. The world-famous Rialto Bridge stands proudly above the Canal Grande. The Venetians breathe a sigh of relief when the tourists leave the city. At last, La Serenissima belongs to them again, even if only for a short time. Many churches were also donated by rich Venetians, and the architectural style is unmistakable. Daily life here is different, surrounded by water. Everything is built on piles, which were mainly hammered into many small islands. In the past, there were several workshops which were allowed to produce the special transport vehicle for Venetian water channels. But today, the gondola is only used for tourism. The Venetians have never discarded the soul of their ancestors, never changed their habits, and never lost the feeling of being the rulers of this extraordinary and mystical city. ¶¶ mighty walls protect the Romanian city of Sibiu, formerly known as Hermannstadt, which was named European Capital of Culture in 2007. The Lutheran Johanneskirche, St. John's Church, is located in the upper town. After its renovation, two organs and sacral art objects, such as two valuable winged altars and a baptismal font, were exhibited here. On the way to the centre, there is the Orthodox Cathedral, which was only built from 1902 at the seat of the Metropoli of the Romanian Orthodox Church in only 4 years. The large church with a domed main room is modelled on the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. The oldest wall and iconostasis paintings are the work of Octavian Smigliesci, who created a synthesis between Byzantine and Romanian folk art. The city was founded in the early Middle Ages by German colonists and was granted the right to mint by King Andreas II. In one of the most beautiful and largest Gothic apartment buildings in Romania, the History Museum is housed in the Casa Altenburger. The history of the settlement is shown in vivid scenes, from the Stone Age to the Middle Ages, and coins and secular and liturgical treasures are kept in the former residential tower. Magnificent patrician houses with restored facades decorate Hewitt Square, the place of the clergy, and also the spiritual centre of the city. Here, the romance of former times is alive, and the statue of Bishop Georg Daniel Deutsch rises in front of the mighty church facade. The Transylvanian Saxons cultivated the land in the Carpathian Curve, built villages and towns, survived the attacks of the Ottomans, and brought about flourishing economy, trade, and culture. From all sides, several stairs and paths connect to the upper city. Almost all the houses on the square had shops on the ground floor where trade took place. And under the arcades, merchants and buyers could shelter from the rain. The former marketplace of the craftsmen appears to be constantly under the watch of the council tower. It separates the square from the great ring. The views from the tower are overwhelming, and in good weather, you can see the Carpathians. The old town has kept its charm, and the lower houses on the main street have been preserved in an exemplary manner. The heart and centre of the old foundation is Piazza Mare. On this large square in front of the Roman Catholic Church is where the most important events took place. Inside, the late Baroque appearance, which the Jesuits once shaped, was successfully preserved. The representative church was built along the lines of the Counter-Reformation. Sibiu is rightly a place of world culture. Isfahan, half the world. With its historic centre, this oasis city, situated on the banks of the Zanderud River, is a gem of ancient Persia and one of the most beautiful cities in the Islamic world. The captivating and atmospheric Friday Mosque attracts many visitors throughout the year. In the centre of the inner historic city is the modest Pilar Halls Mosque. Close by is a mausoleum in which are located both of the Prophet's descendants, Ebrahim Batha and Zain al-Abidin. Lush flowering gardens with ponds welcome travellers following their strenuous caravan journeys, with garden palaces such as the Kaki Çeçel Sotun. An audience with the Shah in Esfahan was always a major event. In the Nightingale Garden is the Hasht Besht Pavilion, the place of eight paradises, which was used as a harem. Following the death of Shah Abbas, around 30,000 Christian Armenians settled in the Julfa district, where they built the Saviour Cathedral. Inside, the Christianization of Armenia is represented. A special attraction is the admirable Kaja Bridge, the most beautiful in the city. The grandeur of Islamic architecture is reflected in Imam Square, the central square of the Safavid era, known as the Image of the World. It is seven times larger than the Piazza San Marco in Venice. In its centre, flowers, lawns, shrubs, and a large pool with fountains. Shah Abbas could not live to see the completion of his mosque. It is of breathtaking proportions and contains the oriental splendour of precious seven-coloured glazed haftrang tiles. The Ali Kapugate Palace is located in the middle of the western side of the Maidan. Its canopy, supported by various columns, artistic stucco and inlay work, adorn a grandstand from where the king surveyed athletic events and parades. Opposite is the Lotfollah Mosque, whose dome, despite its modest dimensions, is a masterpiece. It is possibly the most perfect faience dome in the world, both in colour and pattern design. There are always groups of visitors who are entertained, and the pageantry portal in the north of the square leads to the Kezriye, the imperial bazaar. It is considered one of the largest in the world. Fabric printers and coppersmiths work here, alongside keen spice merchants and jewellery designers, and traders offer fruit and fabrics. Esfahan possessed many mosques and caravanserais. Since 1979, the Abbasi family has owned the most beautiful hotel in Iran. People still live in the spacious buildings today, just as the travellers of the caravans once did. And even today, the magnificent Safavid furnishings bring the fantasy of the Thousand and One Nights to life. Esfahan is an architectural work of art. One of the most beautiful cities in the world. From the Domburg, the view onto Tallinn, the capital of Estonia, is most outstanding. Here, the atmosphere of the Middle Ages comes alive, and the exterior of St. Marian Cathedral demonstrates the simplicity of life in the 13th century. Inside, the coats of arms and tombs of German knights indicate that Mass has been read within these walls. Beside it, blows a breath of Russia. The Russian Orthodox Alexander Nevsky Cathedral. Tsar Alexander III had the church built as a symbol of Russian sovereignty in around 1900, integrating it into the Russian Empire. Also in the upper town on the Domburg and opposite the cathedral is the Parliament building. Its well-preserved defensive tower was part of the Teutonic Order's stone castle. Town Hall Square is typical of the old towns of the Middle Ages, with church, town hall, council hall, and Gothic townhouses. This is the fully preserved Gothic town hall. Many an important decision has been made within the venerable council chamber. Pick Street leads past typical trading houses, such as the House of the Blackheads Brotherhood. As well as the magnificent Olai Guild building and the House of the Lord with the Monocle, including the Three Sisters. Nikolai Church is situated in the lower town. It was built by German merchants in 1230 AD. Today, it is a museum with sacred medieval art. 3 meters thick, 16 meters high, and 4 kilometers long, Tallinn's fortified city wall encompasses the entire old town. Fat Margaret and 25 towers have managed to survive the ravages of time. Olai Church is regarded as the city's main landmark, with its proud 159-meter-high tower. In 1267, the church was the tallest building in the world. Following repeated fire damage, Tsar Nicholas I had it restored in a simple manner. The fantastic view from the tower served not only for the safety of the city, but also as a landmark for those at sea. In 1718, Tsar Peter the Great had the Katharinenthal Castle built in the middle of a huge park on the outskirts of the town. This Baroque splendor was to be the summer residence for his wife Katharina and the whole Tsar's family when they visited Tallinn. Unfortunately, the Tsar died before completion of the castle. Now the Estonian Art Museum was inaugurated and unique collectibles are exhibited within the Chamber of Silver. Park and castle became a popular excursion destination for the upper classes. Also in the Bay of Tallinn is the seaside resort of Pirita, where it is easy to forget how the town flourished through fishing and commerce. Samarkand, Pearl of the Orient. This, one of the oldest and most beautiful cities in the world, is located on Uzbekistan's ancient Silk Road. The introduction of Timurid design was rich with glazed tiles and decorative ceramic architecture, styles previously unknown here. Coloured mosaics of astounding luminosity compete with glazed relief ceramics whose ornamentation is composed of arabesques, font characters and geometric shapes. Tilokare Madrasa is located at the Registan, the big square. The magnificent portal is a testimony to the ruler's self-confidence. Amir Temur, founder of a world empire. The Rukobod Mausoleum was constructed for Sufi Sheikh Sagashi under Timur's rule. Nearby is Guri Amir, the grave of the prince, his mausoleum, and that of one of his relatives. 9 cenotaphs of precious stone mark the tombs that lie in a crypt below. The Bibi Khanim Mosque should become the largest Friday mosque. Opposite is the Bibi Khanim Mausoleum, a brick building with a blue glazed dome. According to tradition, it contains the tombs of Timur's favourite wife, her mother, and 3 nieces. The market is not far away. It would not be inappropriate to consider this place also a special kind of cultural site. There is haggling and chatting. The Shahi Zinda Necropolis, a pilgrimage destination, existed long before Timur. According to legend, it contains the tomb of Qusam ibn Abbas, a cousin of the Prophet Muhammad. Numerous mausoleums line the narrow streets, and its interior is quite remarkable. It's tantamount to being an outdoor museum of Timurid architecture. On a hill above the necropolis is Afrosiab, a pilgrimage site of pre-Islamic times, the Hazrat Hizir Mosque. The Afrosiab Museum contains archaeological finds from the period up to the Arab conquest. On the hill there was once Marakanda, capital of Sogdiana, a prosperous city that was famous in the whole of the east. In the north, the Siab River Valley with the sacred source. And situated on a slope lies the tomb of Daniel. On a hill on the outskirts of the city, Ulugbeg had built an observatory, which reminds us of the astronomical obsession of the wise nephew of Amir Timur. Samarkand is a legendary tale of breathtaking beauty. Within the southernmost archipelago of Dalmatia is one of the most fascinating harbour cities of the young Republic of Croatia, Dubrovnik, a Mediterranean city with a great history. This, the Pearl of the Adriatic, was founded in the 7th century. An ancient courtyard gate leads to the old town and to Luther Square, the city's main square that contains a fine clock tower and splendid palace loggia. The 16th century Sponza Palace consists of a combination of designs, including both Gothic and Renaissance, and once contained the customs house and mint. The City of Stone had its heyday in the Middle Ages and was one of the most important economic and cultural centres in the Mediterranean. Close by is the magnificent Baroque Velika Gospa Cathedral, which was built between 1672 and 1713 on the ruins of a Romanesque basilica. The interior impresses with its mighty dimensions and remarkable main nave and light-filled dome. and with Baroque figures and beautiful paintings. Founded as the Roman settlement of Rasium in the 7th century, the city was inhabited by the fleeing people of nearby Epidaurus. Then Ragusa fell under the protection of the Byzantine Empire until the 12th century, and then of the Venetians. In the historic centre is the location of the small Gothic St. Spars Chapel and the wonderful Onofrio Fountain. An abundant source of fresh spring water that supplied the city's population. Beyond is the Franciscan church that was rebuilt following an earthquake. Only the marble pulpit has survived. Solemn Baroque surrounds the tomb of city poet Ivan Gudulic. The adjoining Malabraca Monastery was built in the 14th century, the oldest part of it being a splendid cloister. This shady courtyard is framed by 60 splendid stone columns. Stradun is the name of the historic centre's lively main street, into which narrow side streets lead. It travels in the straight line of the original marshy channel that once separated the island from the mainland. From the 13th century, the city was fortified with powerful walls that now rank among the largest and also the most beautiful in the whole of Europe, and from where the city can be surveyed. Ragusa was subsequently renamed Dubrovnik, and due to its magnificent location, unique old town and beautiful buildings, it has become tantamount to a work of art. A treasure trove of history. Rosenberg ob der Tauber, a city located on the Romantic Road. The huge Röder Gate is one of several entrances to this former free imperial city that is protected by a high wall. Where Germany's Middle Ages have been preserved right up to the present day. Röder Lane leads to both Röder Arc and Marcus Tower. In the centre of the marketplace, with its Gothic town hall and tower, there's a fountain and also a Renaissance town hall. The museum, with medieval showrooms, still reflects the character of a gloomy time. From the high town hall tower, the names German Jerusalem, or the highly built town, begin to seem more understandable. From the market square, the Herrengasse leads down to the Burg Gate. The Franciscan church dates back to the Middle Ages, with numerous stone tombs on the walls. Next, a fortified city gate, the Burg Gate. It is the city's oldest and largest gate tower, which originally contained a drawbridge. The main St. Jacob's Church construction took more than 100 years. Its interior is a stunning example of German Gothic design. The 12 messenger altar, the main altar, is one of the most important in Germany. Behind the organ is the Holy Blood Altar, an ancient religious relic. Each of the subjects of the Free Imperial City of Rosenborg was able to see from a distance the landmark of the city. The old city has a long history, and the noble buildings that flank the marketplace form the vibrant center that we see today. From here, the Oberschmiedgasse leads down a hill, past the stylish Baumeisterhaus. Continually presenting charming views of gates, towers, and houses. Another strongly fortified gate is both defiant and powerful, presenting a coat of arms above the outer gate. The Mühlacker Steg along the city wall leads to the southernmost tip of the city, where there was once a hospital. It was here that the mighty hospital bastion was built. Seven gates were secured to a sturdy portcullis and an impressive drawbridge. Here, a small town developed at the intersection of various trade routes, with tightly packed buildings that were protected by a long, curving city wall. Even today, the city's high walls and narrow streets give the visitor a feeling of safety and security. It's not surprising that Rosenborg, located above the Tauber Valley, is a very popular tourist destination. A fairy tale picture postcard city. Kraków is considered the cultural capital of Poland and has played a prominent role in Europe for several centuries. In the Middle Ages, the city was fortified with double walls, 47 fortified towers and 8 city gates. Through the Florian's Gate, the path leads to the large Rheineck Market Square, which still forms the centre of the old town today. The most splendid basilica in Kraków has towered over the city since the 14th century, with the main altar of the Nuremberg-born Veit Stoss. Gothic, historicism, Baroque and Art Nouveau are represented under the sky-blue vault. In the middle of the market square stands the famous cloth halls that are landmarks of the city. Because the city hall was demolished, the 70-metre-high and slightly slanted town hall tower now stands alone, right next to the cloth halls. St. Andrew's Church is also one of the oldest churches in the city, built in the 11th century and later rebuilt. Right next to it is another magnificent building, St. Peter and Paul Church, which is the Roman Jesuit church and resembles Il Gesù, a foundation of King Sigismund III Vasa. The Wawel Hill became a national sanctuary, an embodiment of the highest spiritual and patriotic values of Poland, a symbol of religious and political tradition. The Gothic Cathedral was built on the large castle grounds where the Polish kings were crowned and buried. Although they originate from different epochs, the individual parts of the cathedral work as a unique whole. A bastion of historical value for the former splendour of the kingdom. King Sigmund Stari had Italian artists build the castle and the arcade inner court. The extensive historical quarter Kazimierz was originally built as an independent city. Nearby is the Baroque Pauline Church on the Rock. The crypt beneath the church became the National Museum for renowned Polish artists and scientists. The parish church of Kazimierz stands on the market square. This church of the Augustine order was also donated by King Kazimierz. From the beginning, on the area was the Jewish quarter with the Isaac Synagogue. The interior of the Remu Synagogue is simple and sparse. And next door, at the old Jewish cemetery, gravestones reveal the history. With ongoing change, the neighbourhood developed into a trendy party zone. The old synagogue Stara is now a Jewish museum. The temple is the oldest synagogue in Poland. The metropolis on the Wieślę River radiates energy and atmosphere, a mixture of culture and the essence of being alive. From history and modernity, from future and legends. Kyoto is considered to be the cradle of Japanese culture, an ancient imperial city with 1,200 years of history. Emperor Saga honored the monk Kukai by giving him the Eastern Toji Temple as the center of Shingon Buddhism. The lecture hall is home to a figurine mandala consisting of wooden sculptures. A tranquil sanctuary. The Nishi Honganji Temple is the main temple of the Jodo Shinshu school, a particularly fine example of Buddhist architecture. The temple halls and gates are adorned with elaborate carvings and further decorative elements. A shining example is this magnificent Chinese gate with its motifs and Chinese lion. Five buildings of the complex have been designated as national treasures. The superb Nijojo Palace was built as a residence by Shogun Tokugawa Ieyasu in 1603. The palace gardens were remodeled by Kobori Enshu to commemorate Emperor Gomizunu, one of the most famous garden designers in Japan. The palace consists of five buildings offset to each other, and a moat defends. On the northern edge of the city is the Kinkakuji Temple, the Golden Pavilion. It is one of the most beautiful buildings of the Muromachi period, whose gilded facade reflects in a pond. In 1394, the Golden Pavilion and gardens were created. The Japanese Emperor Gokomatsu was also received here. The Kamigamo Shrine was one of the most influential and powerful shrines during Heian times. It was founded in the late 7th century. The site existed in its present form in the 11th century. Its 36 buildings are classified as national cultural treasures. Philosopher's Walk leads to the Ginkaku-ji Temple. The extensive gardens not only represent the height of that epoch, but also a time of despair. The private villa of Shogun Yoshimasa was his retirement home. The well-preserved Gion Quarter, east of the Kamo River, is known for its traditional performances such as tea preparation, koto music, or courtly dances. Kyoto is the ancient Japan. In the mountainous highlands of Ethiopia, there's an extraordinary treasure of the history of mankind, the 11 rock churches of Lalibela. In the 13th century, the famous Amhara sovereign Lalibela decided to establish a new Jerusalem in his kingdom. Unique in their construction, the rock churches are amongst the most little-known miracles of the world, well disguised in the red, tough rock. This monolith church was completely carved out of the rock. Then the masons worked on both the external and interior design. From floor to ceiling, domes, windows, doors and pillars gradually developed. Everywhere you can see Aksumite design. The interior of the rock church looks like a fully furnished basilica, with narthex, nave and aisles. Paintings of biblical motifs and stone ornaments adorn both columns and walls. It is believed that Bet Mariam was the first building of King Lalibela's rule. Lalibela was the most important king in the Zakwe dynasty, in whose honour the old capital of Roha, located in the secluded mountains, was renamed. When a boy, Lalibela was chosen by a swarm of bees to be king. The colony of bees gently enshrouded him like a cloud, a heavenly sign. The external pathways are narrow and difficult to negotiate, and in each small niche live priests and monks who tend to the churches. The various caves and chapels each have a name, such as Adam's Tomb and other biblical names. The route leads back to the surface, down the mountain, and passes the traditional village of beehive huts. Next, and seen from above, the most beautiful church of all in the form of a Greek cross, Bet Georgi, consecrated to Saint George. According to legend, the pious King Lalibela wanted to create a new Jerusalem, and the valley of the River Jordan was designed to separate the two groups of churches. At first, from a corridor, only the facade is visible because the churches are hidden within the rock. Inside is a small central area which connects adjoining rooms that are dedicated to the archangels Gabriel and Raphael. Winding and narrow, the route winds upwards. From here, Bet Emmanuel is seen in all its glory, as well as the unique design of the famous churches of Lalibela. For more than a generation, many skillful stonemasons from Jerusalem and Alexandria carved out this eighth wonder of the world from the volcanic rock of the plateau. According to legend, to replace the exhausted stonemasons, God himself sent hard-working angels to continue the work throughout the night, thus helping to create the New Jerusalem in Lalibela. Český Krumlov, an extraordinary city full of living history. The Budweis Gate has secured the Czech city from the north since the Middle Ages. From here, it has been patrolled and guarded. On the slopes of Castle Hill is the Lateran district, whose inhabitants formerly ran the castle's finances. A narrow lane leads up to the centre of the inner town. Place of Harmony Square is flanked by townhouses, most of which date back to the Gothic and Renaissance periods. These ornately decorated historic buildings have been well preserved and are fully reminiscent of the Middle Ages. Although the wheel of the small mill below the castle is now silent, the mill race continues to flow and crosses a bend of the Vltava River. Wooden stairs form accesses. Here the river divides naturally between downtown and Castle Hill. And the weir controls the wild current. The young Vltava passes the Egon Schiele Art Center. The Edvard Beneš Bridge is a further entrance. A steep stone staircase leads up to St. Veit's Church, where the prelature stands adjacent. On this hill, the best preserved patrician houses are lined up close together and open up free views of the castle and the Lateran district. The city has not always enjoyed economic prosperity. However, there is little to suggest those hard times now. The interaction of the river and the old town is an indelible feature that adds to its timeless beauty. But there have been times when the river has flooded this area and the beautiful Vltava has become a raging torrent. The path leads through the Red Gate to the oldest part of the castle grounds. The moat contains a number of bears. The second courtyard was once guarded by the castle guard, along with various cannons. It was originally an early Gothic residential castle of the House of Witkowci. That was followed by the Rosenberg family. They lived and ruled here for about 300 years. Then the Habsburgs, and soon afterwards followed the princes of Eggenberg. The remarkable Český Krumlov continues to exude a sense of living history, with fascinating impressions and insights into Bohemia's past. Over the years, the original character of the western section of the French Gardens transformed into a park influenced by English design. It followed the German House of Schwarzenberg, which in 1863 relocated the residence to Hluboka. But the castle and town have been preserved and rightly protected by UNESCO. And now it's easier for the traveller to understand the diversity of culture, the history of peoples and nations, and also to recognise similar roots of faith. Throughout history, mankind has been creating its capitals of culture.